Listen.
Sara Vaughan, Ella Fitzgerald, Billie Holiday, Peggy Lee, and Nina Simone. Five queens of jazz who helped to forge the soundtrack of American life in the mid-20th century. Creatures of troubled times, but resplendent in their poise, virtuosity, and musical truth, these women triumphed, often at great personal cost, both embodying and transcending their era. From the way they sounded, to the way they looked. From the joy of seeing them, to the pain of being them, this is the story of the Jazz Queen. These are images of the lost world that paved the way for the great jazz diva, America at the dawn of the 20th century.
All of the great figures who invented jazz and the classic American songbook were born in the same period. They were all born in the 1890s, early 1900s. They grew up listening to the same thing, subject to the same social conditions, reading the same newspapers, hearing the same recordings. But even though they don't know each other and may not be thinking of themselves as one big group, they're all feeding off each other. Have we seen anybody like Ella or Sara in the last 30 or 40, that's a long time, 30 or 40 years? They belong to their time.
Their time was the mid-30s to the mid-60s, three glorious decades that now seem as remote and romantic as the jazz diva herself.
There's certainly something a bit exotic about them. And singing those beautiful songs, full of imaginary late night hangs in speakeasies and telling these wonderful stories.
It was a smoky place because people were smoking, not because there was a smoke machine. And there was a mist in the air because there was sweat and smoke together. And there was a grit and dirt about it, and it was very cabaret.
People still felt the need to believe in something bigger. And you strove, you had a reason to strive to be better.
It was a golden era of songwriting, a golden era in great bands, and it was a golden era of singers.
The jazz diva transcends ordinary life. She came into being during the golden age of Hollywood, which is why she looks like a movie star, and why her demise coincided with the death of old Hollywood. But while she reigns supreme, her looks could be as mesmerizing as her voice.
It was all about mystery. And I think mystery is one of the most beautiful things to feed people's imaginations.
That whole glamour thing that happened, it happened from ordinary women up. So if you were in show business and you had photographers, you had that beautiful lighting and black and white and all of the paraphernalia that goes with presentation.
They look magnificent. They're overly made up. Their hair is in a bouffant 6 inches above their heads. They're wearing these sleek, satiny gowns or beaded things. And they're beyond gorgeous.
They're very human, very real, approachable, untouchable. Yet better than we are. That's just it.
Nina Simone. She was like a goddess floating through. She literally, at the Concertgebouw in Amsterdam, she seemed to float up the stairs. She had this gown on. She looked like the Empress from another planet, like from a Buck Rogers or Flash Gordon movie. The elegance, the surreality of it all, and the down-to-earthiness of it all, that was unique. And that was Nina Simone.
The talented female jazz singer wasn't always in control of the way she looked. Sara Vaughan's early image as just one of the band was radically changed by her label Columbia Records on her way to individual diva stardom.
They're the ones who changed her teeth. They changed her hairline. They're the ones who taught her how to be gowned. They're the ones who put her in the spotlight and told her how to stop being the gawky New Jersey girl who won the Monday night competition at the Apollo, and to be a diva.
My heart's in a dither, dear, when you're at a distance. But when you are near, oh,
but some jazz queens succeeded in creating their own look from the ground up. Peggy Lee's image as a cool, white, sexy screen goddess with a voice was entirely of her own making.
She ended up designing her own gowns, and she knew her figure. She knew what she wanted to look like on stage. She had a strong idea of who she wanted to be, who she wanted this persona of Peggy Lee to be. And she didn't want somebody else to dictate that to her.
You're sitting down wondering what it's all about. You ain't got no money, they will put you out. Why don't you do right like some other men do? Get out of here and get me some money too.
Behind the glamour of the jazz diva often lurks the potent mythology of a troubled childhood scarred by all kinds of deprivations, hardships, and abuse.
It's a sort of cliche now, isn't it? You know, they had early struggles and bad times, and it gives depth to what you do. And it is, I suppose, in a way, it does. Billie Holiday had a dreadful childhood. She was abused. She was in an orphanage. She was farmed out to a madam to clean the... I mean, the worst things happened to Billie Holiday as a child. And people say, you know.
You can't listen to Piaf and not know her early life. You can't listen to Billie Holiday, particularly when she's older and frailer and absolutely not in the space, without knowing that she's a drug addict. You can't do that. You can't separate the information.
Hush now, don't explain your my joy and pain. My life's yours, love. Don't explain.
There's a part of me that says, you know, the personal lives of the artists, I mean, you know, for all we know, you know, Brahms may have had a sour stomach, you know, but Billie Holiday, we tend to read into it. But I think that she, like all these other people, was such a great artist that her stuff transcended it.
Thousands of people had horrible childhoods, and they weren't Billie Holiday. They created what they did in spite of it all, not because of it.
Some come from hard backgrounds, of course, but not all of them did. Sara Vaughan had a quite nice middle-class upbringing, you know, and wasn't too, you know, up against it like, let's say, Ella Fitzgerald was.
Sara
Ella Fitzgerald and Billie Holiday were born around the same time. They have both had very horrible childhoods. What I don't hear in Ella's voice that was very present in Billie's voice is the pain. Ella suffered, but somehow that did not translate in her delivery.
My fur coat's so low, Lord, ain't it cold? But I'm not gonna holler, cause I still got a dollar, and when I get low, oh, I get high.
Ella Fitzgerald had a very tough start. Her mother died very young, she was in an orphanage, she was running the numbers for the mafia, she ended up in some very, very dodgy situations. So you don't always have to parade your neurotic, awful behaviour in this terrible life you've had.
Once Ella gets close to tragedy, to the dark side of Billie, for instance, it doesn't sound right. It doesn't. She's acting. But if it's cheerful, cheerfulness keeps breaking through with her.
I lost my yellow basket. Won't someone help me find my basket and make me happy again?
Was it red?
No.
Was it green?
No. Just a little yellow basket. A little yellow basket.
The shiny white carapace that was the glamorous facade of Miss Peggy Lee reflected nothing of a childhood spent at the mercy of a cruel stepmother and an uncaring alcoholic father.
That's how she got through her childhood, I believe, is through music and writing songs in her head and singing. She didn't want to talk about her problems on stage, but definitely all of that was there with her when she sang. I couldn't not be.
For all of those women, the important thing was the music. They were in it for the music. Music was the thing that saved them.
They're trying to solve a problem. They're trying to fix something, and they're grasping at straws. And sometimes they must feel like they're falling and they can't grab onto something that will hold them together, and this is the nearest thing.
The effect of years of unhappiness and not having love and not knowing that you really are worth something, it's very difficult to instill that in someone who doesn't feel that.
Annie Ross knew about childhood unhappiness. She arrived on an immigrant ship from Scotland to New York in 1934, only to be left there by her parents in the care of an aunt, the singer Ella Logan. Only 4 years old at the time, Ross was a precocious talent destined not only to discover the work of the great American jazz divas, but also to be a fellow traveler on the jazz highway.
The first time I heard Billie Holiday, the first time I heard Sara Vaughan, the first time I heard Ella Fitzgerald. It's such a blissful thing to know that you're young and you've got to listen to all these people. It's breathtaking.
Those that have shall get, those that don't shall lose. So the Bible says, and it still is news.
I hated being a child. I hated my childhood. I never wanted to be a child. I wanted to be grown and free.
But God bless the child that's got his own. That's got his own.
Singing was part of me. And it was the one treasure I had.
If singing offered a way out of a bad situation for a girl with a voice, her best escape route in the 30s and 40s was to join a band, most of which were comprised entirely of men. She might be hired just to be looked at, to be what the band often called the canary.
We keep spending all our time in beauty parlors.
They were definitely a flower, you know, because people maybe get tired of just hearing that do that it that do that that hour after hour, blah blah blah. Finally, a singer coming out. She's dressed lovely and.
Sing is the cabaret.
Most of these singers were not of the musical level experience of the musicians in the band, so I don't think that they cared very much about them. They were a cutie pie, a guy or a girl. They were cute, and the young people came to see them, and they sang their song, and they got off.
Well, I think the band always was a little bit snooty. You know, the chick singer was a big joke.
The difference was when a Billie Holiday or an Ella Fitzgerald or a Sara Vaughan, even at their earliest stages, were on that bandstand, I think it became very clear to the musicians that they were dealing with, at the very least, a peer, and for probably many of the musicians, someone who was superior to them.
Ella Fitzgerald, you know, initially people didn't want to hire her because she was overweight and they didn't think she was pretty enough.
She really didn't look that great. Smelled a bit. Her first frock was a whip round from the band.
They said, well, we can't have her. Look at her, look at her. And Chick Webb heard her and he said, yes, but she can sing. We can fix the look. You know, we can fix the look, but we've got to have her.
The Queens of Jazz began their careers with busy swing bands under the control and leadership of famous band leaders such as Benny Goodman, Chick Webb, Count Basie, and Duke Ellington. This meant spending months and months touring on the bus.
18 guys in the band and a girl singer. It's 201-nighters in a row, some of them. And it was a constant 300-mile trip every night.
Ella Fitzgerald was the life of the party. She was the only girl on a bus with a big, you know, big orchestra-sized bus traveling around, whether it was early Chick Webb when she was 16 or it was Duke Ellington later on. And those guys were working every day, sleeping, sitting up.
How did they present themselves night after night as a figure of glamour? What kind of mental strength and backbone did it take just to get out of bed, look nice after 8 hours on a bus without being able to eat or use the bathroom on the way, and then in a crummy backstage dressing room, if there was a dressing room, probably just the backseat of a bus, apply the makeup, put on the gown, and go and satisfy with these people who came to hear the band wanted to see as the figure of glamour, of sex, of femininity?
Certainly was difficult, but you know, you're young. So riding on a bus with all these guys was great. You know, the really hip guys sat in the back. But I found love there.
Love wasn't the obvious thing to find on a bus full of male musicians running on a tank full of testosterone bound for jazz glory.
Some girls had reputations, I suppose. You know, she might have done the saxophones first and then the trumpets. Oh, no, start with the rhythm section, wouldn't you say? Yes, if you want a good beat behind your sing.
That was tough. Tough on a girl. Good, 18 guys taking a shot at her all the time.
There were guys, sure. I was young, you know. It was quite a combination of music and love. It was a fascinating world. I loved it a bit.
But the fascinating world, tin-canned by the tour bus, would sooner or later have to disembark in those parts of the country where skin color mattered much more the musicianship.
There were still, you know, black toilets, black restaurants, You couldn't go into the white ones. It was kind of embarrassing.
Going to towns where you went in through the kitchen and people spat at you in the street. If you were a black woman, your life was untenable in the South. And if you were a white woman, people thought you were a slut and a whore.
What was it like being a black woman and singing to all these white guys in the audience that, you know, were noisy and rowdy and disrespectful? How did you do that?
They had a sense of expression and a family within the musicians that they worked with. They did have their art as a kind of salve, a kind of balm to heal over it for a time.
If being part of a big band offered the black female jazz singer comfort and protection in a white male world, it was also where she learned about how to be a musician herself.
Ella Fitzgerald, being on the bandstand with Chick Webb every night. Can you imagine what she learned about rhythm from him? Billie Holiday, for 1 year, night after night with the Count Basie Orchestra.
Them that's got shall have, them that's not shall lose.
So night after night hearing that, and also them hearing her.
Mama may have, Papa may have, but God bless the child that's got his own, that's got his own.
When you sing with a big band and you learn the discipline that goes on in the big band, you're special.
They weren't in charge of their repertoire. The arranger said, I think we'll do this, or the band leader said, why don't we do that? And so, in a sense, they had this quite demanding apprenticeship.
Someone like Peggy Lee, when she got with the Benny Goodman Orchestra in 1941, you know, she wasn't the Peggy Lee or 5 or 6 years later. There was time for her to mature.
You know, when you work with Benny Goodman, if you just keep your mouth shut and watch what's going on, it's a college education. It's 4 years of college with Benny. And that's what she got.
You had plenty money, 1922. You let other women make a fool of you. Why don't you do right?
She was just a member of the band. She was one of the instruments. And she needed to fit in and conform and please Benny.
And get me some money, too.
See, Benny says, don't do that. Don't do that. That's the way you do it. He's the boss.
But the power of the big band bosses didn't survive World War II. Nor did the bands themselves. Their personnel decimated by military service, the rebuilding of lives after the war, the expense of big band touring, and union trouble. While the men were at war, a new kind of woman had slipped out of the kitchen and into popular entertainment. A woman of dubious virtue, with a troubled past and an uncertain future. Resourceful, independent, even dangerous. The femme fatale. Meanwhile, the hippest sidewalks now marched to the tune of a new kind of jazz called bebop. Modern jazz for a modern age. Perfect for a new kind of modern musical woman, the jazz diva.
After World War II, when the bands died, the singers were liberated, and the really good ones had a glorious decade in the 50s and early middle 60s. They were all signed to major labels. They recorded with luxurious orchestras and string ensembles. They were backed up by radio. There were jazz clubs around the country. And there were the record companies themselves that knew how to publicize them.
The jazz diva's time had come. Like a film noir heroine, she took center stage, this time in a smaller group of musicians playing more complex music for audiences to listen to. No longer surrounded by 20 guys in a big band whose main job was to get people dancing. Now she was the focus of attention.
With Ella, I think what musicians listen for is the sheer perfection of, first of all, the instrument, her diction, and her phrasing.
Heaven. My heart beats so that I can hardly speak.
Ella's music came out so perfect, it would be the envy of any composer to be able to write the thing that she sang.
Say, hey, the boy from Ipanema. Say, the boy from Ipanema. Say, the boy from Ipanema. Ipanema. The boy from Ipanema.
They say that when she first joined Chick Webb's band, she'd come on and she was like completely sort of blank. She would stand there and the music would start and she'd suddenly come to life. And as long as the music was playing, she was animated. She was moving about, she was smiling, waving and so on. And the music stopped and she stopped.
Get.
The great jazz divas were able to steal the limelight by virtue of their own very special and private instrument, one that they played inside their own flesh, their voice.
Singing is the most intimate form of music making. Every other musician on the stage has a filter between himself and the audience, and that's the instrument. But the singer is naked. It's all about her insides, her diaphragm, her vocal cords.
It's different from every other instrument because of that. It's inside you. Every part of you goes to making that sound.
The jazz diva is born with her instrument. It's uniquely hers.
They had a good sense of how to make themselves individuals. And that was something that no one could really take from them, and that was where their power was.
And they were copying no one else. They were the beginning. Ella Fitzgerald says that she loved Connie Boswell and wanted to sound like her. So they had people there, I'm sure, Bessie Smith and other blues singers from before their days would have influenced them, but they were trailblazers.
And no one could blaze a vocal trail like Billie Holiday.
Treat me right, baby. Just treat me right, baby.
You cannot teach someone to sound like Billie Holiday.
I don't know. Billie, what have you done? I don't know. It's just so free and natural. And man, did she care if she was drunk? No. To imitate her would be folly.
You couldn't stop her and say, oh, you shouldn't be doing it like that, because it was too subtle, it was too cute. Everything has a sheen, a perfection to it, and it seems so carefree and so lazy.
Her tuning was impeccable. She was off her tits most of the time, you know, and her tuning was bang on.
You hear her life, and you hear her truth. I think a lot of people throw out cliches like that, but it's actually true. Truth is what you hear.
With Billie Holiday, you begin with the strange fact that she only has a range of about 12 to 15 notes.
If you were to look at what she sings written down and then look at the song copy, the notes go up and down like this. Billie just goes like this.
It's the opposite of Sara Vaughan. Sara Vaughan could probably have done opera if she'd been born in a different world.
I heard her singing Bali High on an opera version of the musical South Pacific with Kiri Takanawa. I mean, and Sara's voice is as pure and powerful and beautiful as Kiri's soprano.
Sweet and clear as can be. Come to me, here am I.
Yes.
Come to me, if you
wanted to be her manager. But Sara was of the school that her manager had to be her guy, you know, and that was her school. She always felt that way, and she never found the right guy. I was not interested in being Sassy's guy. I respected her as an artist. I thought she was a beautiful woman, but that wasn't what I wanted. And so that didn't work. Sara was a great artist who also understood modern jazz, also understood modern harmonies, because she came up through the Charlie Parker, Dizzy Gillespie era. She was their singer.
I don't know why, but I'm feeling so sad. I long to try.
Just about her first record she made, a Dizzy Gillespie and Charlie Parker on it. And it was a bebop record. And in the late 40s, she's singing the sort of thing that most instrumentalists couldn't get at, let alone singers, and she never, ever put a foot wrong.
The jazz divas were able to sing in a way best suited to their individual range and personality because of technical advances in microphone technology. As these sculptural devices became more sensitive, so the jazz voice could become more detailed and powerful, or more conversational and minimal.
Someone like Billie, who came up in the age of the microphone, couldn't belt out loudly, but they could bring it down to like what Marlon Brando did later, which is just to that, you know, that essence of the slightest movement.
No jazz diva embraced the microphone age more than Peggy Lee, whose solo career motto was softly with feeling, which she coupled with method actor minimalism.
Never know how much I care. When you put your arms around me, I get a fever that's so hard to bear. You give me fever.
She kind of toned it down and made it almost conversational and made these rowdy clubs that she sang in come to her.
She's almost purring at you, isn't she? And the sound is so intimate.
Fever in the morning, fever all through the night.
Stillness, and she's just like that. And her hands, she's like still.
You give me fever when you kiss me, fever when you hold me tight. Fever.
Just two pieces, bass and drums. Fever, balloon. That was her arrangement, you know. She would whisper when she sang, and she sang beautiful slow tempos, and she sold the lyrics, and she made you believe it.
Peggy Lee believed that every song was a little story that had to be acted out and stage produced. The person she chose to do this was Miss Peggy Lee, a persona she constructed right down to the last detail.
We would go into the dressing room and she would start a transformation with makeup, with hair, with the costume. And I would watch this person, my grandmother, become Miss Peggy Lee, the star. And then I would run around, go out into the theater and watch her, and it was amazing. I have to say, it was amazing for me. And then she'd come off stage and she'd be just high. And then she'd say, oh, I'm just famished. And we would go to McDonald's or Carl's Jr. or something, Wendy's.
But Peggy Lee was white. Popping out for a bite to eat after the show hadn't always been an option for those singers who were black, however famous they were. Racism was still at the very dark heart of jazz in America in the 60s. The struggles for African-American female singers were doubly daunting.
Well, they are queens. I mean, they're royalty in American culture, but they're royalty during a fractious time in society, I mean, before desegregation in America. To be a black woman in America before the civil rights and even during the civil rights movement is, it's got to be something that's unimaginable today.
They'd be people that'd be worshipped around the world and couldn't go into a restaurant in America. This creates tremendous psychological problems.
These ladies experience that even though they are divas, they could be well-known selling, you know, tens of thousands of records, and they're going to have these moments every day.
And if there's trouble in the land, then you got to sing about it. You've got to. And that's what these women did.
Southern trees bear strange fruit. Blood on the leaves and blood at the root.
Those singers can deliver performances that reach a level of emotional uneasiness for the audience that is profound.
Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
Protest music. Jazz has always been protest music, and it's supposed to be.
Sometimes when we listen to Ella Fitzgerald and we hear her sunny disposition, we think that we're not hearing so much of a reflection of the tough times of the era as when we hear someone like Billie Holiday. But I think if we take a step back and think, what did it take for Ella to present that face? I think with all these iconic figures that we're talking about, whether it's Billie or Sara or Ella, all those great African-American women who were trailblazers, anything and everything that we saw of them on the stage spoke to their condition of the time. Now, this is either by omission or you have to dig deeper underneath the surface to see these things.
The youngest of our jazz queens found omission impossible. You don't have to dig very far beneath the surface of Nina Simone's music to find the racial indignation of the last of the great jazz divas.
I don't belong here, I don't belong there. I've even stopped believing in prayer. Almost, but not quite.
She took the race issue on in that she actually became involved with the whole civil rights movement. She took it on at a very different level.
Well, that's just the trouble. Desegregation. Mass participation. Unification. Do things gradually. Will bring more tragedy. Why don't you see it? Why don't you feel it? I don't know. I don't know.
There was a woman who had enough balls to talk about the things that nobody wanted to talk about and do it in a way that it wasn't Entertainment Tonight and it wasn't television. It was real and it was significant.
You don't have to live next to me, love. Just give me my equality, love. All men know about Mississippi. Everybody knows about Alabama. Everybody knows about Mississippi.
Here's somebody with a great talent and a great genius and a great composing genius who took a social stand to the detriment of her pop career. She was being molded to be like a Sara Vaughan or an Ella Fitzgerald.
It was a song that she sang after the death of Martin Luther King. There was such disgust in her voice. She gets to this lyric, he was not a violent man. He was not a violent man. Now, she could sing it that way. But she sang it, he was not a violent man. I mean, she just squoze all the juice that she possibly could.
He was not a violent man.
shot down the other day.
The voice is sometimes not beautiful. She's not easy to listen to sometimes. Sometimes she's so in the space of whatever it is she's telling you that you there's no distance between the information and you, and it rips your heart out.
And did Martin Luther King just die in vain?
Nina Simone didn't have a choice. Ella Fitzgerald didn't have a choice. They do what they do. So when one tries to figure out, did they trade this off at the expense of that? They didn't have a choice. Nina Simone's voice wouldn't work, her brain wouldn't work, her heart wouldn't beat if she wasn't gonna sing Mississippi Goddamn.
Nina. I choose Nina over all of them because she was crazy enough to do it and she was sane enough to make it sound right. She was also the kind of woman who, apparently, she put a man up to gunpoint to return a pair of shoes, which is pretty crazy. I like that story.
She was proud, but the jazz diva proved that love has no pride. Although she transcended her time, she seemed to be its victim when it came to romance. Behind all the poise was the pain of man trouble, which she endured, like a sacrificial heroine, for those audiences that preferred their jazz divas colored blue.
Billie Holiday was a masochist. I mean, I think literally a masochist, from what I understand. She chose bad husbands, she chose bad lovers. She, my next-door neighbor, the late Billie Taylor, you know, told me a story of seeing her beat up once by her manager husband in a club in front of other people.
Even though she has always been reported to be at the very least bisexual, if not often gay, she loved men. She liked having a man in her life. And she chose the worst possible man. I mean, she just chose one thug after another. Sara Vaughan, whom I knew quite well, did not do a lot better. I mean, she just seemed to choose men who would exploit her.
I'm going to say something that will make a lot of women very unhappy. But all those singers, every one of them needed a man. They needed a man behind them. You need that support. And for a man to take that time to give you that support means he doesn't have his own life. They were taken advantage of. They all ran into problems because these guys looked upon them as meal tickets, and they needed that. I don't know why, but philosophically and psychologically, they needed that.
What's interesting about all of them is the number of times they all get married. You know, there's a big thing going on with marrying a lot. And I think that that's partly because that's a protection, you know, and there's a lot of marrying your musicians.
Peggy Lee's first marriage was to Benny Goodman's guitarist, Dave Barber. They had a child, but that turned out to be only the first of four marriages for Peggy, who was likely to greet a husband with the unwelcome news that dinner wasn't ready, but the song was.
She really did want that white picket fence, that dream of a everlasting love and a family. She really wanted that. She wanted that dream of the folks who live on the hill. That song was her favorite song. And it's not surprising. It's just about this love that grows old together and stays together. That, unfortunately, is not what she got. But what she did get was this unbelievable career.
So the choice, you know, life or art, isn't straightforward because what you get from art is life.
Meanwhile, Billie Holiday made private disappointments the very subject of increasingly painful public performances in the unflinching glare of the spotlight.
But I love him. I don't know how I should. He isn't true. He beats me too. What can I do?
I do sing it, and I always say, preface it with saying, well, it's of its time, you know. It's still a great song.
He'll never know. All my life is just despair.
And, you know, sometimes he beats me. It's in the lyric. And, you know, I don't know, I should. He isn't good. He isn't true. He beats me too. But what can I do? Oh, my man, I love him so. And you think...
What's the difference if I say...
I always imagine that outside the spotlight, the circle of rather blank, faced, mild-looking men, rather interested by this, you know. And the women, I think, just think, you know, thank God it's not me. Well, the question is, what were people... What was it? What was the attraction for people?
Schadenfreude is one of the more disturbing aspects of the human condition, that we get pleasure out of pain.
Other people's pain.
They're singing the songs, the emotions, and sometimes the solutions to life's problems. They're sometimes solving it. The question, solving the problem for people.
One person has a hard time, and the other person who's sitting in the audience listens to it and hears those words, like Ray Charles' Hard Times, man. My mother told me, before she passed away, said, darling, when I'm gone, don't forget to pray, 'cause there'll be hard times, who knows better than I? You know, when he says that, I listen to that and I go, man, well, I soon found out just what she meant, had to sell all my clothes just to pay the rent. I did that like 8 times in my life. Man, when someone writes a lyric that is real, everybody understands.
I mean, it sounds like you're talking about the Greek Furies all of a sudden, and we're going back to the whole problem of catharsis, you know, that we all need that. We need to believe in these stories in order to purge the pain from our own lives.
Another way to purge the pain from your life was to develop a keen appetite for all kinds of drugs. Jazz's default setting in the bad old days.
I think singers in the 50s would be stumbling upon all sorts of stuff going on. You know, heroin was rife, cocaine, you know, everybody was smoking reefers, everybody. I think you'd have to dodge it to not come out unscathed, you know.
In the 30s and 40s, and I've interviewed a lot of musicians on this, the idea that heroin was suicide was not generally known. It really wasn't. People thought that they could take it, and if they exercised a lot and ate well, it was less dangerous than alcohol.
It's one extreme to the other. You're either really busy or not have anything to do whatsoever. You're teetotal, or you're getting drunk out all the time. Loads of different things. It's all just one extreme to the other in most musicians' lives.
As with everything else in the world of the jazz diva, Billie Holiday fulfilled the role of drug addict better than any other jazz queen, with fellow heroin user Annie Ross sometimes on hand to take care of her.
When she was really bad, and when she wasn't, I would go up to her little apartment. I remember I even gave her a bath because she said, I'm too weak. I said, I'll do it. And I would sit by the bed so that as she smoked, she wouldn't burn the place up. And she would watch cartoons. She loved cartoons. And I was happy to do it. I mean, this was my idol.
Did Billie need to be on drugs? Did Lester Young need to be on drugs? Did Charlie Parker need to be on drugs? You know, maybe they did. Maybe they did. Maybe that was part. And all I know is they could play a song and make you cry.
Thank you. And I'd like to do a little tune titled Please Don't Talk About Me When I'm Gone.
The last time I saw Billie live, her voice was light and ooh, what a little moonlight can do to you, you know. Lovable, huggable Emily Brown, Miss Brown. She was singing all those songs.
Please don't talk about me when I'm gone. No, our friendship ceases from now.
I says, lady, you sound better than I've ever heard you. And she says, I'm straight now, George. I'm straight. What are you talking about? Drugs. You gotta help me.
It makes no difference how I carry on. I don't.
4 weeks later, she was dead.
Please don't talk about me when I'm gone.
Lady was dead at 44. Long live the lady. She was, of course, the first of the great jazz divas to die on the job. But they all had to face the treachery of their own unique instrument, their body, letting them down.
I know that I'll be contented with yesterday's memories, knowing you'll think of me once in a while.
In the latter years, her highs were getting lower and lower, and her lows were also not there. She was only singing in the middle range of her voice. Ella Fitzgerald, with only this much, sang more than anybody else.
She lived for it. And even though she'd like nearly smoked herself to death and had both her legs amputated and she's wheeled onto the stage, she's still doing it.
Sara Vaughan had that funny joke. She'd be perspiring, she'd have a drink of water, and she'd say, every night I come up here looking like Lena Horne and I go home looking like Sara Vaughan. And, you know, so she would make fun of that. She became heavier, she became more diva-like, but she was Sara Vaughan. And she could get away with that because her genius was so undeniable.
We seem like passing strangers now. How can you hurry back there when we're two who love half as much as you and I?
Don't look for me.
Peggy Lee decided to keep Miss Peggy Lee, the performer, alive until the bitter end. You can still be running a fever when you're virtually bedridden.
She arrived in a limousine, and they wheeled out this wheelchair in sequins.
Don't smoke.
It was covered in sequins. And as she came in, she went, thank you, for being here, thank you, And they announced Miss Peggy Lee. The lights went down, the lights came back up, and like magic,
there she was.
Now, imagine this woman having had a stroke, wearing a blonde pageboy wig, big glasses with rhinestone, so you were distracted from her face a bit. And she started to sing, Fever. She used to always start with her hand out like that. That always when she started that song. Well, she'd clearly had a stroke. So what they did, they had the drummer play the sound and her hand lightly snapped. But there was the drummer, like, right on time. And when she got to the point where she said,
Fever,
she held both hands up like that and then brought them down in a series of steps. She no longer had the fluidity or the timing in terms of her hand movements. But still, you learn how you can adjust a performance.
I think it's really hard for a singer to age in front of us on stage. When you're a beauty and you're singing about desire and you're trying to be sexy and you're singing Fever and Big Spender and I'm a Woman.
I can work out 44 pairs of socks and have them hanging on the line. I can stretch 92 dozen shirts before I can count 1 to 9.
But then, do you stop? Like, she didn't want to stop singing.
But in truth, it was curtains for the jazz diva by the mid-60s. She was consigned to history by the triumph of pop and rock, leaving her struggling to remain relevant, forced to cover the odd Beatles song. Nina Simone, who had always embraced every kind of music, made it across the bridge from the lost world of the jazz diva to soul, R&B, gospel, and beyond.
Hey, Lordy, Lordy, Mama, what you gonna do?
There's a lot of singers and a lot of people in the world, but nobody reminds me of Nina.
Tell me what you gonna do now, what you gonna do?
I wish I could have met her and hung with her and gotten all kinds of trouble with her. That would have been my sister. I'm not in trouble enough. I'd like to be in trouble with Nina Simone.
And don't know how to treat her.
Nina is just a big soul that nobody... I don't even know how they got her into a casket because her soul was so big she didn't have a place to go, you know?
The Ellas, the Sarahs, the Billies, the Dinahs, the Anitas, the Peggys, they become more and more magical because we know we're never going to see their like again.
These women were the first, and they're the originals and the best. And I often wonder why I even bothered doing it, because it's been done so well before. These are women that were artists, and they found a platform to be artists and to be heard and to be accepted and to be subtly, freed.